In my book, American Werewolf in London is the best werewolf movie ever made, and The Howling is the close runner-up. Both were released in the same year, and the same special effects expert, Rick Baker, was involved with both productions. With both films, the highlight selling point that got talked most about upon release was the detailed on-screen transformation of a man into a werewolf. Both scenes were kind of revolutionary on the visual effects front at the time. However, the context and intent of the transformation effects in each film is very different. In The Howling, a woman is cornered by a madman as he transforms into a wolf, and his intention appears to be to terrify her as much as to kill her. In this scene, we are supposed to identify with the trapped victim, but in American Werewolf in London, the protagonist is the werewolf. He changes while he's alone, and so we are supposed to identify with him. Fitting with these differing intentions, the wolfman in The Howling appears to enjoy his transformation process, or at least he enjoys trying to terrify his victim with the transformation. But in American Werewolf in London, the transformation process is torturously painful, so core differences in the nature of the horror. The special effects techniques used are very similar, fleshy-looking prosthetics combined with underlying animatronics and inflatable bags, a mixture of man-in-a-mask effects with some shots discarding of the actor altogether and replacing him with a sophisticated puppet. However, the quality of the two scenes isn't just about how realistic the effects look. The behaviour of the transforming werewolf is totally different. The camera work, editing, light, music and acting are also very different between the two scenes, and each of those factors has a significant effect of its own. So let's start with The Howling. A few other scenes earlier in the movie help set this scene up psychologically. The werewolf guy was initially assumed to be a sexual killer, and Karen, who is a journalist, puts herself in great danger to try and track him down. She meets up with him, and he shows her footage of what appears to be a rape murder about to happen before he begins transforming, but he's shot by the police at the last minute. We don't get to see him transform, but we hear the changes in his voice and some flesh and bone transformation noises. Later on, the same guy, having survived the cop gunfire, returns to kill women again. In this scene, he kills a woman, but only after playing with her and presumably enjoying her terror in the build-up. So these two precursor scenes establish that the werewolf is an evil character who is actually in control of his transformation abilities. He doesn't change involuntarily under the moon, as traditional werewolf stories would have us believe, but rather he can trigger the transformation when it suits him. He's also been established as a sexually aggressive threat with the cruel motives of a serial killer. And the fact that we've already seen what he does to one woman appears to be an attempt to set up a strong sense of anticipation regarding the journalist when she faces the beast. However, for me, this would have been a lot more effective if the first female death had been more savage. This woman just didn't look scared enough, in my opinion, and her death was simply a brief bite to the neck that kills her in seconds, with no blood shown. Compare that to the terrifying first attack in American Werewolf in London, which is a great setup to instill fear about the fates of other victims later in the movie. Nevertheless, the serial rapist killer framing in The Howling does work well, and it's significantly helped by the casting of a guy who oozes sexual evil. His stubble, pale skin, caveman-like long hair, red eyes, and his already enhanced carnivorous teeth make him truly menacing. It's a nice contrast against his quite normal-sounding voice.
You said on the phone that you wanted to get to know me. But here I am, Karen. Look at me.
Plus he's tall with a large face, which makes him more threatening again. Another trick used in the scene is almost of a magical ghost-like nature. When Karen enters the room, she sees the previous female victim on the stretcher. She then turns and steps toward the phone for a moment, and when she backs up toward the stretcher again, the werewolf guy leaps up from under the sheet. So in the space of about 10 or 15 seconds, he's moved the other woman's body off the stretcher, then laid down and covered himself up without making the slightest sound. It's implausible, but it's dramatically effective because it gives him further magical allure and because it furthers his motive of tormenting his prey before the kill. So he says he wants to give her a piece of his mind, then pulls a bullet from his skull. That's a nice pun. The transformation starts, and he appears to express pleasure in the process while stepping forward to ensure that she can see the details of the change. His eyes turn white, like his identity has suddenly become a blank canvas, then close and open the eyes again, and they're now green, animal-like eyes. And this is a pretty damn creepy image. He's got the teeth-bearing, wide-eyed look of an animal preparing to attack, but he's also grinning at Karen's helpless predicament. And he's intentionally showing her his extending talons. The blood on his fingers appears to be from when he pulled the bullet from his skull. Decent growl noise effects here too. The music is moderately effective, but personally I think a fearful heartbeat approach would be better. Something along the lines of the build-up music in the bathroom scene of The Shining. Now there's a big problem with this scene. Like the girl who was killed earlier, Karen doesn't look scared enough. To see a man transform like this would be absolutely terrifying. She would be either panicking and trying to run out the room, or cowering in the corner and screaming for help while trying to avert her eyes from the horror. I don't know if it's bad acting or bad directing, but it seems the attention here has been skewed towards showing the effects rather than enhancing the dramatics. This was director Joe Dante's fourth film, and for the most part he does a decent job, but his skills significantly improved after this film. He did the amazing third episode of Twilight Zone the movie, which I have a detailed analysis of on my site if you're interested, and he did Gremlins, Inner Space, and the brilliant comedy The Burbs. So back to the scene. Decent I'll huff and I'll puffed chest expansion. Interesting, by the way, that he was a werewolf just a couple of scenes earlier, yet he chose to become human again, and now he has his clothes on and is shredding through them. So, assuming the filmmakers had actually thought this issue through, he must have stripped off before changing the last time, and after killing this girl, has put his clothes back on. Or this is a new set of clothes that he's found. Think about it, the logical way to play out this scene would have been to have him start out naked and transform from there. Whether intended or not, the result is an implication that he wanted Karen to see the clothes torn through. We could even take it as an implication about the potential tearing of her flesh. Carrying on, a good detail is the use of snot and saliva on the werewolf's mouth and nose. It adds a bit of visceral gross out that helps offset the weaker aspects of the effects, which we'll come to in a moment. John Carpenter's The Thing included loads of slime and goo to give life to the prosthetics, and there's another feature here that is also used in some of the Thing's effect shots. The creature violently shakes as it transforms. Right, so some of the weaker aspects of the effect start to kick in now. The actor seems to have been replaced entirely now by a puppet head. The big giveaways are the plastic-looking fixed grin and the obviously fake movements of the eyes. The head is also too still, like it's positioned on a table or something. When it's the actor, we see his head tilt about here and there, but not so for most of the prop head shots. An attempt to offset this has been made here by having the camera move down and gradually tilt up to keep the face in shot, and I think it's supposed to imply that he's getting taller, but it doesn't quite work because the striped shadows from the windows across his face are fixed. If he were getting taller, then those shadows would be moving slowly down his face. That's a difficult trade-off because the shadow across his eyes seems to be there to help hide the fact that the eyes are obviously not organic, they're fake. The issue of how to create convincing eyes on an entirely prosthetic head has always been a major problem in monster special effects. It's still a problem even in today's CGI effects because our brains are so intricately sensitive to the fine nuances of how real eyes behave, not just the eyeball movements and pupil dilation, but the various squints and other movements of eyelids, upper cheeks and eyebrows. There's a really, really intricate psychology and physiology to that stuff. For example, here the eyes are too big and wide open. The irises of the eyes have been made huge to offset the fact that the whites of the eyes generally are a giveaway about unrealistic eye movements in prosthetic fake heads. That's why loads of prosthetic monster masks and makeup in movies feature bug-like eyes with no whites. And during all of these prosthetic head shots in The Howling, the eyes never blink. I must also note here that there's an interesting comparison to be had with this sequence in which the Jack character in American Werewolf in London is replaced, the actor himself is replaced by a prosthetic head, which has eyes that move about, animatronic eyes. But they sort of get away with it a little bit in this scene because there are no eyelids. It's a lot easier to have fake eyeballs turn than it is to have fake eyelids blink. So that's an interesting little point on that. In The Howling, a similar problem to the eyes is also occurring with the mouth. A fixed grin is stretching out in a way that looks unnatural. It's obvious that this is not a grin expression, but a stretching of flesh that poorly imitates a grin. And the head is too still again. Musically, a kind of UFO noise plays over most of the sequence, a sort of woo-woo-woo. It definitely sounds like something from a sci-fi film, and I suppose it could be taken as a kind of magical framing of the transformation. I suspect that the scene would have been scarier without it. So, ears growing out now and snout emerging. The movement of the fingers only seems to enhance the fact that certain facial features are rigid, as is the head's position. This looks a bit better because the head is moving about a bit more. Same here, bit of head movement, but still the eyes look dead. The scene is also dragging on quite a bit. The snout takes ages to emerge, so a shorter edit would have been better. The full transformation takes approximately 3 minutes of screen time, but I think it could have been safely chopped down to 2 minutes. Having the beast close its eyes during these final stages might also have offset the obvious lifelessness as well. I also think this scene might have been better if it was less thoroughly lit too. Some areas of absolute darkness in the face I think would make it more scary, perhaps even have the front area, especially the eyes, in total darkness, save for some noticeable eye glint. But as happens all the time with CGI today, the temptation is to make all of the effects fairly well lit so that the details are noticeable all over. I think a better option here would have been to have some sort of light that comes and goes. Like if this were near a highway, then the highlights of passing cars outside could cause brief lighting of the beast and moving shadows from the windows and blinds. Briefly showing a special effects shop for a second or two without dwelling on it is a great way of offsetting the unrealism. It denies the audience the time to consciously notice unrealistic details. Or have a table lamp or two in the room and have the beast move about during the transformation so that some of its changes are partially lit and others are in darkness. Another option would be to have her turn her head away in terror and show her expression in focus with the beast's face transforming out of focus in the background in some of the shots. That would help offset unrealistic details such as the eyes. Oh, a quick mention of another subliminal detail. In this set, there are human anatomy pictures on the walls implying what's happening beneath the flesh of the beast as it changes. Okay, so now she throws acid in its face. She reaches behind her for a jar without even knowing what's in it. And who leaves a jar of concentrated acid lying about with the lid off? Her acting is really poor here. No real sense of fear, and the camera angles are hardly dramatic. Plus the music and the noises from the wolf aren't too good in this end part of the sequence either. So, not a very good ending to the scene at all. It started off scary, but the special effects problems of rigid puppet heads with fixed eyes and fixed grin and a terribly filmed acid-throwing moment spoil it for me. Still, on the whole, it looks better than CGI because we can tell that a physical monster prop was actually in front of the camera, not superimposed with a computer. Right, so let's move on to the American Werewolf in London transformation scene. So this scene kicks off with a shot of the moon as the trigger of transformation, which is very different to The Howling. And the music kicks in too, Bobby Vinton's version of Blue Moon. You saw me standing. What an odd choice considering the content of the scene. We'll come back to that. So we start with David reading a book and there's no slow build up here. He launches straight into agony and a few moments later, transformation. Now there's a particular reason I like the sudden emotional shift, and it's a reason that might not have been intended. David has total amnesia about his werewolf experiences the next day, and funnily enough, a good way of inducing amnesia is to make a person go through a very rapid transition between differing emotional states. Hypnotists can do this. By bringing a person rapidly out of a trance state, the chances of amnesia about what happened in the trance state increases. Bring them out slowly and there's a chance that the brain will, during the transition, create neurological connections between the two states so that memories of one state can be accessed while in the other state. A more common example we can all relate to is when awakening from a dream and only remembering the dream for a minute or two and then forgetting it completely. The emotional and physical difference between the sleep state and the waking state is so strong that certain memories are only accessible in one of the states but not the other. That's why our memories of dreams tend to disappear rapidly. So, the rapid emotional transition for David in this scene is a really unusual facet. I like that. David also shouts something very specific during the shift of emotional state.
Jesus Christ!
Now that's significant because the overall scene includes assorted references to David's dead friend Jack, who was killed at the start of the movie. David feels guilty about having run away and left Jack to be slaughtered by the beast. Not that he could have done anything about it anyway, but his guilt is there throughout the film. Jack shouts, "Jesus Christ," in his moment of sudden attack from nowhere, and David does the same thing during his transformation.
Are you gonna help me up or what?
So David, now in pain like Jack was, and screaming that he's burning hot, strips off. Initially tearing his shirt at the neck area like Jack's clothes being torn in the same place. Camera pans out to a kind of Hawkeye view to reveal that what we're about to see is a transformation of a character who is fully naked and fully lit, which is an incredibly difficult task to achieve with practical effects. The increasing hair between shots is an obvious visual cheat, but this reverse footage later on that gives a more convincing impression of growing hair is excellent. Apparently they pulled the hair backward through the fake flesh and then just reversed the footage to give it the appearance of growth. Personally, I think it would have been good to include the reverse footage growing hair shot very early in the scene so that the jump cuts between different lengths of hair would have been more justified as the scene went on. As for subliminals, check out the big butterfly props above the fireplace. A butterfly is the end result of a transformation, like a werewolf is. The hand change looks great, and its out-of-focus reflection in a mirror is one of those little details that you typically wouldn't get in a CGI rendition. One of those many little details that just gives prosthetics that sense of it's there. Now, unlike The Howling, where the victim watching the transformation hardly looks scared at all, David's pain is intensely convincing. Someone I really care for. Then suddenly that appears for me. It hurts so much that he can't even breathe, never mind scream. This brings me back to the issue of the gentle music. An absence of music or the inclusion of a horror score would likely make this scene too scary for what director John Landis wanted to achieve, because actor David Norton does such a great job of appearing to be in excessive pain. Landis wanted us to be fascinated with the special effects of the change, hence the transformation into beauty metaphor of butterfly props, one of which is actually human flesh-coloured, by the way, like his hand in the same shot, and also the full lightings so that we can really marvel at the effects. Usually music is for emotional enhancement, but here it deliberately offsets the scariness of the scene, which I think is a testament to how well directed and acted the scene is. It never ceases to amaze me how good acting can bring a sense of realism to the most ridiculous of scenarios in horror or science fiction. In fact, a very wise choice has been made in that respect by having the body do most of its transformations before the face does. This allows the actor's real expressions to be used through most of the transformation, unlike with the Howling scene, where the fake eyes and fixed smile are a fake giveaway for the last half of the sequence at least. Another note on props is that there's a Donald Duck figure on the mantelpiece and the Mickey Mouse figure that Jack held is visible in several shots. Both of these cartoon characters are hybrids between human and animal, which is what David is becoming. The Mickey Mouse figure is shown in close-up toward the end of the scene, like David's friend Jack is saying,
"Hi, David!"
Or,
"But I did tell you so, you schmuck."
But again, I think there's a subtext here of David feeling like he deserves his pain for having abandoned Jack when he was attacked. Both of them scream for help and receive none. David tries to apologise to Jack as if he thinks Jack is the one putting him through this agony. That's a sure sign of guilt. And immediately after he makes this apology, he's subjected to another wave of pain.
"I didn't mean to call you Meatloaf, Jack! Oh, 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 oh."
Almost as if Jack rejects his apology. Weird. Having David fall to the floor and roll over several times during the change is great because it makes the scene visually dynamic and it allows different parts of the body to be shown in close-up as they change. When we get the wide shot of David on his back, it's kind of obvious that the legs are fake. They don't move convincingly, so the actor is sticking out of the floor, basically. But being that the film has established clear comedy elements, it can get away with the odd bit of weakness in the effects. I do get the impression that this shot is partially played for laughs anyway. However, like I said, the use of an actual actor who is doing a good job of acting offsets these things. We naturally feel empathy when we can see someone's eyes, especially up close, and Landis capitalises on this by having David look straight into the camera and reach out to the audience for help. That's a brilliant touch. This eye contact with the camera used to be done in really old comedy movies all the time. Laurel and Hardy were masters of it, and it seems to have been a sort of leftover from the era of vaudeville stage plays where people would look and talk to the audience as they were acting out a scene. It creates a greater sense of personal connection between characters and audience, but today it's virtually never done in movies. Filmmakers have such a strange preoccupation with so-called realism, but they have it on the wrong levels. The audience always knows deep down that the movie they're watching is fake, so it's okay for the filmmaker to acknowledge and use that awareness. Filmmakers very often allow this kind of connection with the audience to be done with audio narration where the character speaks to the audience. So why not allow the occasional glance to the camera from the actor in key situations? Landis used it for subtle comedy effect at several points in his classic comedy movie Trading Places.
"Commodities are agricultural products, like coffee that you had for breakfast, wheat, which is used to make bread, pork bellies, which is used to make bacon, which you might find in a bacon and lettuce and tomato sandwich. And then there are other commodities."
Now, on that issue, I mentioned about the fake-looking guys in The Howling. This is where American Werewolf in London gets things right. When it comes to the snout transformation, David closes his eyes so that we don't have to look at lifeless fake ones. Combined with the mix of a human scream of pain and an animal howl, plus the bone-crunching effects and the rapid speed of the snout emergence, this is an absolute winner moment. Vintage cinema. Of all the shots in the movie, this was the one that most imprinted on my brain in my first viewing. And before we even have a chance to say to ourselves, "Hey, you've cheated by hiding the eyes," the edit cuts to an extreme close-up of the eyes opening back up again and looking right into the camera at the audience. Again, the power of having a protagonist look at the viewer. And as far as I can tell, those are a real pair of actors' eyes, heavily surrounded by prosthetics and makeup and with some hefty contact lenses. The way the eyelids open is too realistic for prosthetics. If it is fake, then it's pretty damn good. But even with contact lenses, there can be a problem in that the pupils don't dilate. In an extreme close-up like this, the lack of pupil dilation would begin to register on the viewer's mind, and so the shot lasts about 2 seconds at most, then cuts away to the ears growing. Then, a last couple of shots of the full snout growth. And again, the absence of a real actor is offset by the fact that the eyes are closed. But for me, these two shots don't work as well as what came before. For one thing, they're on screen long enough for fakery clues to register, so maybe doubling the speed of these shots might have assisted the scene. It's good that the head moves about and shakes, unlike in The Howling's weakest effects moments, but like with The Howling, there's a problem of fixed expression around the mouth. The lip-like area, I think, would have been better being darkly coloured, and crucially, I think a lot more saliva around the mouth and nose would have helped. That's one detail where The Howling does a better job. And even on first viewing of American Werewolf in London, the teeth always looked wrong to me in this design. They appear to point outward, whereas large fangs typically curve inward on carnivorous animals so that they can hook into flesh and tear it. Some more hair around the face could have offset the rubbery look here, and it would have helped bridge the gap to the next shot panning over the whole beast where we briefly see a fully haired face. There is one tiny logistical aspect of the whole scene that I guess the film had to do narratively speaking and just about gets away with. David has left the door open to the hallway and onto the street to let some air in. This allows his wolf form to get out of the building and go on a kill rampage. But during his transformation, he's screaming and no one in the building or in the street outside hears a thing. If you've ever been to London and seen how crowded it is, that's kind of unlikely. So anyway, two great scenes, the two best werewolf transformations ever put on film in my opinion, and both released in the same year, with the same effects artist overseeing both sets of effects. Although the intention of the scenes is different in that we're supposed to fear the changing beast in The Howling and identify with it in American Werewolf in London, and both do a good job in those respects, I think American Werewolf in London is the more effective scene dramatically in terms of faster pacing and visual variation. It's about a minute shorter than The Howling in terms of the effects portion of the change, and it crams a lot more varied detail into those 2 minutes. But especially, American Werewolf in London's avoidance of using fake eyes gives it a huge advantage over The Howling's excessive use of them. Not only does it avoid the fake look, but keeping the actor's face present and only minimally changed almost until the very end of the sequence maintains the feeling that a living human is transforming before our eyes. There's a real artistry to these kinds of visual effects. It's not just a case of how realistic looking the prosthetic puppets and makeup are in themselves. They usually look pathetically rubbery when we see them on set, fully lit, and held on screen for a long time. Something that looks ridiculous on set can look great on screen if it's lit correctly, given the right amount of slime or goo on its surface, is combined with the right sound effects, and depending on whether it's held on screen long enough for the audience to start consciously noticing the artificiality. That's a crucial factor. And that's a big problem with CGI these days. CGI shots are held on shop for ages so that we can look and go, oh, look at the detail in that. But the longer it's on screen, the faker it looks. Okay, that's it. More videos and articles on film analysis and psychology at collativelearning.com. I've also got a very long detailed study on An American Werewolf in London that's available on my site for sale as well. So grab that one if you're interested because there's tons of psychological stuff going on in that movie. Oh, and of course, if you haven't seen it, check out my comparison of the special effects between the 1982 and 2011 versions of The Thing. Bye for now, folks.